Recently, I had a guest on my vlog, Elise Record, who talked about addition and subtraction word problems. Now, anytime people learn about math problem types, one thing that they want to go do is to go right back and teach the problem types to their students. I'm Christina Tondevold, the Recovering Traditionalist, and I hope you'll stick around as we investigate why you shouldn't teach the math problem types to your students in our quest to build our math minds so we can build the math minds of our students. Now, one of the things I want to start off with is the chart of the story problem types. Now, this chart may look different from one you've seen before. I personally love the one that was started by cognitively guided instruction because that's the first place I ever learned about it. And I like the terminology that they used. On this chart, like, we don't have to go back and help the kids realize which ones are join change unknown and which ones are separate result unknown. The idea is for us as teachers to know these different math problem types exist and be able to make sure that our textbooks are giving kids exposure to those. And if the textbooks aren't, then we've got to create opportunities for kids to have the chance to be able to solve these kinds of problems. Now, the big reason I do not want you to go back and try to teach the math problem types to your students is because often when we teach each problem type, along with that comes instruction on how to solve that problem type. And then students are seeing all of these different rules and procedures for solving all the different problem types, and it becomes too much for them to remember. The idea is to just let kids solve it any way they can. Now, cognitively guided instruction found this nice progression that kids went through as they tried to solve problem types without any instruction from their teacher. If you want more info, I'm going to link to the Teacher's Guide to CGI, which is a great summary that was put together by the University of Wisconsin at Oshkosh, is where I found the link. It doesn't say who did it, but that's where I found the link. And then if you want all the details about CGI and how to implement that into your classroom and learn more about that progression that students go through, then I highly recommend the book Children's Mathematics by Thomas Carpenter and his whole group there. But the big idea is that you give kids a story problem and just let them solve it any way that they can without us telling them, this is this kind of a problem, here's the steps that you do. Or without us saying, underline the important information, circle the numbers, then look for key words, right? We want kids to make sense of the problems and solve it in a way that is natural to them. Which leads me into my last point here, that the big idea that we want kids to take away when solving math problems is that we want them to find the structure of the problem. Like, what's happening in the problem? It's not about finding keywords and the numbers and then figuring out the operation. It's about understanding what's actually happening. Can we act this out? Is there action in the problem or is there no action? Like, sometimes there's actual action. Like, I had $7 and then I lost some. Now how much do I have? That's where things are actually going away. And sometimes there's just no action. Like, I have 7 chocolate chip cookies on the counter and I have 5 oatmeal cookies on the counter. How many cookies do I have? There's no action. I'm not eating any. I'm not baking more. There's just that amount there. There's nothing really telling the kids to put them together except for the question that I ask. And that's where we fall into that keyword trap. We want to help kids be able to use a keyword to figure out what operation to do. But instead, we should be using the big idea, or what I love is Susan O'Connell's idea of key concepts. This is a chart that she mentions in her book, An Introduction to Problem Solving, and I love this idea. We really need to help kids be able to understand the key concept that when you're doing addition, you are putting things together. Now, sometimes there's action in the problem that tells you put them together. Like, I had $7 and then I earned $8 more. That is saying put those together. Kids can have had that experience where they get more money. It gets added to the pile of money that they had, right? But there are times, like the cookie problem, where you aren't, there's no action. You just have what you have. But the idea is, hey, if we're being asked to put things together, that can mean addition. But if you notice in that chart, it could also mean multiplication. That when you're doing multiplication, you're putting things together, but the things you're putting together are of equal sets. So if I had 7 chocolate chip cookies and 7 oatmeal cookies, I could solve that with addition, but I can also solve it with multiplication because they're both put together types of problems. If I'm asking, I got to say the question. The question that I ask is, how many do I have all together? Because I could also take that beginning part of, I have 7 chocolate chip cookies, right? And this one wouldn't really work if I have the same amount, but let's say the original, I had 7 chocolate chip cookies and 5 oatmeal cookies. I could ask the question, how many do I have all together? Which means I'm going to put these together. But I could have asked, how many more chocolate chip cookies do I have than oatmeal? Now, when I'm comparing, guess what? A comparison problem, according to this chart, is we need to subtract. So we can help kids understand these key concepts, because those key concepts always last, whereas keywords don't. All right, so the big things I want you to understand when you're trying to get kids to understand the math problem types is that the problem types are not for the kids. They're for us to be able to understand and making sure we're giving kids lots of exposure to all of them. The other thing is that we don't teach the problem types because then we end up teaching procedures. And instead, we want kids to have the understanding and use their own natural strategies. And then the last thing is help kids understand the structure. Not keywords, not procedures, understand the structure. All right, I hope that this video has helped you build your math mind so you can go build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.